Good morning and a very warm welcome to the 33rd meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2023. Our first agenda item is to continue to take evidence on our past, our future, the strategy for Scotland's historic environment. And we're delighted to be joined this morning by Alex Patterson, Chief Executive of Historic Environment Scotland, and Dr. Adam Jackson, Head of Strategy and Policy at Historic Environment Scotland. And can I ask you please, Mr. Patterson, to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, convener. Good to be back. I've brought along someone who probably knows more about our past, our future and its predecessor than anybody else. So delighted to have Adam with me this morning. I just want to make four points about our past, our future, or OPOF, as we all tend to abbreviate it to. I think the first point I would make is that OPIT, the previous strategy, actually achieved a lot. And therefore, there's a degree of continuity in the new strategy. It's not about throwing out everything. A lot of the good things that were done under the predecessor, we carry forward. But the world has changed, and what the new strategy tries to do is marry continuation of what worked and what was valued with the different world in which we operate in today. I think the second point I would make is it is not a HES strategy. And I think that's an important point to make. It is a strategy for the historic environment. Yes, we coordinated and led its development, and yes, we will have a major role in its delivery, but it is a strategy that's been developed by the sector, beyond the sector, and therefore that has implications for its delivery as well. I think it's been extensively consulted upon, and I'm really pleased that there's been a high degree of consensus around the priorities that the strategy has set out. My third point is simply around something which might seem quite unimportant, but I actually think it's important, and that's the name. Because as we got towards the end of the development and the consultation process, well, what do we call this strategy? And Our Past, Our Future was actually a name that came from various sources as a suggestion. But I think it's absolutely appropriate because, yes, this is about the past and how we look after it, and it's precious and we care for it, absolutely. But it's how the past plays in, not just to today, but to the future. And that's why throughout the strategy and throughout the narrative that we put around about it, this is actually a strategy for a better Scotland and how the historic environment contributes to that. It's absolutely aligned with the National Performance Framework. It's absolutely aligned with Programme for Government. And therefore, seeing the historic environment and its contribution to a whole range of wider agendas is really important. And I hope that comes through in the strategy. And my fourth point is simply about how we deliver this. Because if delivery of this strategy is just down to HES, which it's not, or if it's just down to the sector, which it can't be, we won't achieve it. And there's a real emphasis in the strategy and in the consultation and in how we take it forward that this requires a real joined-up effort of those within the heritage and historic environment sector, but those beyond as well. And mainstreaming and how we achieve that has always been one of the challenges, but that is quite critical to the delivery of the new strategy. We'll do our bit. We have a new team in place to make sure we oversee and drive it, but it is a strategy for the sector and it's a strategy for Scotland, and therefore it needs that joined up approach to achieve its full impact. But with those few comments, thank you, convener.
Thank you for it was certainly brief introduction. We don't always get that, but that was ideal for setting the tone for our questions today. If I could open with a question and a quote from the strategy, because it acknowledges that we will not be able to protect every heritage asset and we will need to make difficult choices about historic places we invest in and which elements of our heritage we can maintain for the future, and we must face all of this within a difficult funding environment. So I'd like a wee bit of expansion on the impact of the funding environment in terms of the numbers that you're able to protect, but also to try and understand if there's a framework or a matrix around that decision-making process and how that develops.
So I think I'd offer you two comments on that. When we were drafting the strategy, we were trying to balance two things. One was, let's have a sense of ambition as to what the historic environment can be and can do, but let's also realise the environment in which we're operating. So it was trying to balance ambition with a degree of pragmatism. And I know the committee's heard it before, but there will never be enough resource, financial or otherwise, to do everything that everybody wants to do. And so we thought it was important, in fact, not just us, but everybody thought it was important that we reflect in this strategy that there will be difficult choices. Not everything is rosy and will be okay. Difficult choices have to be made, and that is the reality. What I think is important is how you make the choices. And you had the director of BEFS, I think, in front of you last week. You might have noticed earlier this week that BEF launched a sustainable investment toolkit. Now, actually, that is an output from the first historic environment strategy, where lots of people in the sector, but asset owners beyond the historic environment sector, said, we're all in the same boat here. And whether it's historic monuments or whether it's railways or whatever else it might be, we need some sort of mechanism, a transparent mechanism for making the choices. So that sustainable investment tool has been very well received, you know, as I say, developed as part of the predecessor to Our Past, Our Future. And it says there are four things, there are four considerations in making decisions. One is the cultural significance of the assets themselves. The second is the economic contribution that they make. The third is the social or community contribution they make. And the fourth is their environmental dimensions as well. So I think what we're getting to, and with the launch of this toolkit by BEFS this week, is an agreed approach and an agreed methodology for helping make decisions, which will be the reality given the financial and wider environment in which we operate.
Thank you. Did you want to come in on that, Mr. Jackson? Dr. Jackson's
right. Not on that point, no.
Thank you. Can I move to questions from the committee and ask Ms. Forbes?
Thank you very much and good morning. Alex, you mentioned that the strategy was not a HES strategy, but you'd obviously led on it. And there are three priorities in the strategy for delivery over the next 5 years in terms of net zero, communities and wellbeing economy. There is no objective in terms of preserving old buildings, which struck me perhaps as the most obvious one. Is that because it's implicit in everything that you do, because there's not an issue there, or for another reason?
So when the strategy was being developed, we could have ended up with about 8, 9, 10, a dozen different priorities. And I think, you know, I chaired a group of chief executives that oversaw this. And we thought, if we end up with a list of priorities like that, you know, the chances of them getting done is remote. So let's really, really focus. And that's where the three came from. The strategy does, however, point out that not everything that we need to do is in there. And so looking after historic properties, whether it's castles or standing stones or tenements or schools, is there and has to continue. So there's a focus on those three things. And in doing some of them, like the net zero, we will be looking after the historic environment. If we get the fabric of historic properties right, it will contribute to their preservation and their maintenance and resilience going forward. But there is a lot of, if you like, business as usual that we will do and other organisations will do that's maybe not articulated in the three priorities, but those three come out as the overarching three from the sector that we should, you know, collectively roll our sleeves up and try and deliver.
I suppose the reason I ask, and I'll come on to a last question in a moment, but is whether there's a conflict between those three overarching objectives, which, to be blunt, could be the objectives of actually any public sector strategy in Scotland. So they're not anything that I would disagree with. But could there be a conflict between those objectives and actually your core remit of preserving historic buildings? For example, if you are investing considerable sums of money in the laudable aims of delivering the transition to net zero, which means that you're unable, for example, to keep the upkeep of another building?
I think it goes back to my previous question. There is not enough resource, never will be, to do everything we want to do. So we as an organisation have a responsibility to look after historic properties. But I've said in the committee before, we can't look after all of them in the same way, to the same degree. And that's why this sort of tool for making choices is actually very relevant. But your point is right. You could have these three priorities for many other sector strategies or many other organisations, and that's kind of good, Because what this is showing is, and this was part of the brief we received from the Minister in terms of developing the strategy, make sure that we try and tie the historic environment, what it does and the contributions it makes to those wider agendas. So if we look, if we achieve collectively some of the aspirations for net zero, it will improve the historic environment, but it will also contribute towards the wider government net zero aspirations. If we invest in the historic environment and the jobs it creates and the visitor income that it generates and all these other economic benefits, that will contribute to the wellbeing economy. So I don't necessarily apologise for the fact you can maybe take the three and apply them to others. I actually think that's quite good. And it's actually saying the historic environment is not left field to mainstream Scotland or mainstream priorities. It's centre stage. And we can deliver those centre stage priorities, but it needs more of a recognition of that, firstly, and secondly, a joining up of the resource across government and across organisations to deliver it.
Last question was really about the portfolio that you have. And, I mean, you've touched on this already in terms of the tools that you use for what you can do and the many things that you can't do. But what expectation do you have that the HES portfolio, for want of a better phrase, will expand at all in the coming years, considering there's no shortage of historic buildings that are in need of a good owner?
So, so two thoughts. I mean, I suspect we will be approached, or ministers will be approached, with a view to other properties coming into care. I think that's quite likely, and you know, we're talking to other organisations like the churches and so on, who are facing similar challenges. But I think it raises a wider issue about what is the PIC portfolio. Is it something that is a collection of assets that you deliberately go out and try and tell the story of Scotland with? It's not been developed in that way. It's a portfolio that's quite static. In my time in this job, no new properties have come in and none have left. And actually, I don't think that's right either. We've had approaches where we've considered a request for a property to come into state care and actually decided the better way is not. And that organisation is now thriving because we've handled it in a completely different way. So there's a question there about what does state care of properties mean going forward and how do we take them in. But I would say that bringing things into care is not the only solution. There are other ways of helping properties and so on, and organisations consider their assets. But I think it is likely that we may be approached. And it's why a few years ago we set out an acquisition and release policy, which actually sets out, so if we get approached by anybody with a view to a property coming into the care of ministers, what criteria would we apply? How do we consider an application, both to come in and to be taken out of care? So if we are approached, there's a very clear approach and methodology that we would apply to consider that. And part of it is about the significance and the historical significance and the cultural significance. Of course it is. But some of it is also about the practical implications of taking something on, but you know, where's the resource that goes with it? Is it going to add yet more to the budget pressures and so on? So there's a whole range of considerations that factor in where that to happen. But I always say state care should not be the last resort. It should be an option, but let's explore other options. And the example I gave just a minute ago was a good one where, yeah, it could have come into care, but the best solution was for it not to be. We're standing behind it in a different way. But if it can be managed by a local community or a heritage agency that's not us, but with our support, that's as good an outcome.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Mr Cameron.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and welcome to the panel. Can I ask you both for an update on the number of sites that remain closed or have restricted access and what the current timetable for reopening those sites is, particularly in light of evidence that we heard last week from Jocelyn Cunliffe, who's the acting chairman of the Architectural Heritage Society of Scotland, who I think was concerned that the full reopening of sites was taking too long.
So I think when I was last here, we talked about this sort of high-level masonry programme, and I think at that time, looking back at my notes, about 35 of our sites that we had restricted or closed had their inspections. Well, now it's 66. which is good. And we'll get all, if you recall, there were 70 sites we identified in our priority list that needed inspections, and we'll have all of them done bar two, and the two are for a good reason, by the end of March next year. So on the inspection side of things, making good progress. At 53 of these sites, we've been able to either reopen them or improve access, but there are still a number that are closed. I think the figure, and it's not just high-level meters, I think it's around about 20. Some of those are closed because they haven't been inspected yet. Some are closed because we're doing repairs with a view to getting them reopened. And some of them are closed and we will reopen because they're seasonal sites and we'll reopen them at the start of the start of the season. So I saw the comment last week. My view is that I think we've made remarkable progress on doing the inspections. I go out and about and talk to community groups, and particularly those where our sites have been restricted, and everybody wants to be first and everybody thinks we're going too slow. But given what we had to do to get this up and running, I personally think we've made remarkably good progress. I'd like it to be faster, but we're trying to do this new work as well as keeping all the other sites that are open, open. And Edinburgh Castle, Stirling Castle needs a lot of work just to keep the lights on day in, day out. So these are the broad numbers. Our priority, whenever we can create a bit of access, whether it's full reopening or whatever else we do. I was in Rothesay a couple of weeks ago. The castle's been closed for a couple of years. I was able to tell them in February the castle will reopen. And we'll get it open. We're working with the community as to how we make a noise about that. But getting it open for the new season is vitally important. My only other comment in this will be, look, I think it becomes business as usual that repair of sites is going to be there. Some of the properties we're working on, I'm afraid there will be scaffolding there for some time because the repairs require quite a bit of work. But where we can improve the access, we're doing it. And I think from where we were in May 2022, from a standing start, to where we are now, I think our teams on the ground have done a brilliant job, frankly.
I don't know if Dr. Jackson wants to come in on that.
Not on the high-level masonry point. Okay. No.
Thank you. Fair enough. One of the points that was made last week was about where liability for risk sits, and where does it sit? Is it with HES or is it with ministers?
Yes. So I'm very clear as the accountable officer for HES that it sits with me. I think the comment last week was if the properties were more, well, they are ministers' properties, they're either in ownership of ministers or in guardianship, that if the responsibility for them was more obviously with ministers, then somehow the risk appetite would be greater. I don't buy that, and I don't buy it for two reasons. One is the legislation applies to all of us, and I think I said to the committee when I was here last year, I spent a lot of time with lawyers asking questions about, you know, how we interpret this, and you know, irrespective of the nature of sites and where they may be, unroofed on cliff tops, the health and safety and occupier liability legislation applies to us, and therefore, I don't think it would make an awful lot of difference. As I say to community groups when I'm out with them, why are we doing this? Because it's not as if we've never inspected the top of walls before. We have, but it's always been a visual inspection from the ground or fly a drone over. And what we basically asked ourselves was the question, does that give us enough assurance about the condition of the top? In other words, if you put a person up there and put your hands on, would it just confirm what we've seen from the ground from a drone? And the answer was, no, that's not sufficient assurance. So the chance of something falling and seriously injuring, or worse, someone who's walking underneath, I can't take that risk. And I don't honestly think if it was more obviously under ministers, they would take that risk as well. That's what we're dealing with here.
And presumably, HES has an insurance policy as well.
Oh, yes, we are insured.
Indemnifies you, yeah. So yes. That's kind of obvious.
Yeah.
Can I...
But I'd rather prevent the incidents happening.
Of course. Can I change tack to another area, which is community asset transfer? Mm-hmm. I was very struck that in Our Past, Our Future, you estimate that around a third of all community asset transfers since 2015 involved a heritage asset, which, as I said last week, was both surprising and pleasing, I think. But it does bring challenges to communities who are running that asset. The National Lottery Heritage Fund, who gave evidence last week, have a proposal for a kind of longer-term support for community asset transfer. beyond simply acquiring it and transferring it to the community, because there are obvious questions of management and maintenance, etc., that continue for a long time. Is that an area that you, as an organisation, are exploring?
I'll give a view, and Adam can give you the right answer, I guess. So we're open to community asset transfers, even of PICs, and we've had a couple of inquiries over the last few years, but they've come to nothing. And I think it's largely because, the obligations and the sort of financial obligations you're taking on and looking after historic properties is quite significant. There has been one example of a community asset transfer of a visitor centre down in Dundonald. So the Friends of Dundonald run that, and we look after the castle. But the general principle of community asset transfer, we've got a policy in that, and that's absolutely fine. If I put on my old hat from a Highlands and Islands Enterprise perspective, we supported this a lot. But the easier bit is actually getting the capital funding to transfer the asset. It's how you make it sustainable. Mm-hmm. So there's lots of support out there. All I would say that from a HES point of view is, and it relates to sort of the wider issue about funding and how you sort of deliver the strategy, we've tried to adapt our grant schemes to make them more accessible for that type of initiative. I think you had Caroline from the lottery here last week as well. We've aligned our grant schemes so it's easier for organisations to approach both of us for that type of both capital and revenue funding. And the example I mentioned right at the start around the request for care that we found a better way of doing, we're actually supporting that community who own the asset and operate the asset through our grant scheme. So I think it is, communities need to be careful about taking things on because there is the sustainability of them and keeping them viable, but the support to do it is absolutely part of our thinking. Maybe Adam can comment on the numbers.
I can't comment on the numbers exactly. I think really it is true that while there's probably no end of appetite out there potentially for communities to take on assets, it is the long term. The problems will still remain often with the heritage assets in terms of their ongoing maintenance and longer term funding. And I don't think the solutions are yet found, as Galax has said, looking at grants and other funders, looking at that too, and potentially, I suppose, looking at how we may enable other ways of making it work in a business sense. And we can support that to a degree in terms of our enabling role in that space. But I think in truth, I mean, where there's a business case, where we can see that there is legacy, that there is a future beyond the first 2, 3, 4 years, a longer term future for the asset, then naturally we are open. And as Alex says, we have a policy on this. I think probably what we need to look at more is how we can work more effectively in collaboration, potentially, and you've mentioned a couple, Friends of Dundonald and things, where we may work more effectively with communities and kind of sharing, in a way, aspects of delivery, and that would benefit local communities. And I'm sure that's a sense more broadly than just HES. So, and that probably will help to address, in part, the issue of legacy.
Thank you both very much. Thank you, Convener.
Keith, you have a supplementary?
A supplementary on the first question that Donald Cameron asked about closed and restricted buildings. I think I'm right in saying, and I'll be embarrassed if I'm wrong, that Clapmanan Tower is one of yours.
Yep.
In fact, I think we've corresponded on it in the past. But that has always been closed, and I don't think there's any plans, as far as I know, to open it. Have you any update on what's happening with that, given its significance?
Can I write to you on it? I mean, we have 336, so I carry some of the information in my mind, but not the specifics. So if I can drop you a note on it, that would be appreciated.
Just generally then, if I can just ask, are there properties like that which have no real prospect of reopening that you have?
No, I've said all along that there is no property that we've said we were not going to reopen. I've also said, because I sometimes get this, that you're just going to leave some properties just to sort of the elements to whatever. No, we will manage every property. Okay. What managing a property means might differ, but we're not going to let things just go. But no, our aim is to get properties open. Some, I'll be honest, will take a bit of time because the amount of work is quite significant. So I can't sit here and say by summer 2024 all the properties will be open. We'll do our best. But the reality is some will take a bit more time. But let me drop you a note specifically on that property.
It's been at least 25 years that I know of, but I'll come back in with a subsequent question.
Thank you. Mr Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. Mr Patterson, you talked about in the opening statement about a joined-up effect, so there needs to be joined-up thinking along how you manage this, and you've touched on collaboration already. And I think that the effect of engagement that you've already seen and done, that comes very evident in the strategy and what you've achieved in the past, is to be commended. But the strategy does require local authorities to be a key player or a key partner in this whole process, because they can provide some of the flexibility, some of the focus, and also the economic benefits that can happen within a location. But within the strategy itself, it doesn't really go into the detail regarding how HSC is going to improve that and the collaboration between yourselves and local authorities. So can I ask, why is that the case, that there's not such detail there?
So can I offer you two answers? I'll offer one and Adam will offer the second. I'll just pick up the local authority specifically, and maybe Adam can say a bit more about our thinking about the delivery model. The previous strategy tried to engage local authorities, and with not an awful lot of success. We want to try again, and one of the things we're going to do around the delivery model is create a steering group, and we're going to invite COSLA to sit on that. But I think beyond that, I'm slightly less worried than I maybe picked up from the committee notes of last week, because local authorities are integral to the delivery of the historic environment strategy and everything to do with the historic environment. And we have multiple ways of engaging with them, whether it's been we're a statutory consultee in the planning process. So we give lots of advice to local authorities on consents and applications and so on. We set the historic environment policy for Scotland, which is part of the planning system, and therefore are considerations that local authorities have to take into consideration when making decisions. The new NPF4, National Planning Framework 4, we inputted a lot to that, so there's elements of protection for the historic environment written within that, which local authorities have to consider when making decisions. So I would say it's not as if we don't have good contacts or links with local authorities. We work with colleagues in local authorities day in, day out, particularly from our heritage and consenting and casework perspective, and there are these mechanisms. But I think one of the things we want to change with our past or future compared to its predecessor is how we deliver and how we deliver more locally. And I maybe just ask Adam to say a wee bit more about that, because I think that gives us another way of engaging local authorities.
Yes, absolutely. Our place in time, the predecessor strategy, as Alex has said, really struggled. In fact, it did have a working group of local authorities which didn't really deliver and was closed down really after a couple of years. In our past and future, we've learned some of the lessons of that really, and realised actually that it's at the level of action, local action, and actually to an extent regional action, that we see local authorities engage. And it hasn't become any easier, obviously, because local authorities have their own funding and other issues playing out. So looking forward to delivery, and I appreciate, and we may come on to questioning around this, that the strategy itself is light on the delivery section. We are committed to publishing a more detailed delivery plan in June, but in June in 2024, a delivery framework which will set it out in more detail. But over the next few months, what we'll be doing is mapping where the actions within the strategy at a regional or more local level, as well as national level, where they can be delivered and how they can be delivered. And we'll be speaking to stakeholders, including local authorities, around those. Because we have to make it, I think, it's a question of negotiation. It's like partnership and collaboration work. You really need to achieve a common goal beyond just the priorities, and the engagement has achieved, I think, consensus around those. Common goal, I think, on the ground in terms of where the benefits may lie locally and regionally. And that's what we're intent on pursuing. That said, I think sometimes we overplay the lack of engagement, as Alex has already suggested, of local authorities with historic environment. There are 32 of them, and their priorities are local. but they are engaged with historic environment day in, day out, and we engage with them on the ground around projects and programmes of work, and indeed around current city deals and growth deals, and those are opportunities as well to play out under OPOF.
As you identified, the delivery of how you manage success and how you measure success is vitally important, and it sometimes comes down to the data that you use, and there's some data that we will always receive, just because of the nature of the business you're involved in. But there are others that are a little bit more technical, or others that are a little bit more, you know, what the environment has to offer, and that's not as easy to measure, depending on how you progress that. So can I ask, you know, how do you try and go through that little minefield of making sure that you get the right data that is giving you the correct information to then put forward some strategy or idea, or you know we're going to go so far on this because we've been told the following? But if you're not told and you don't measure, how can you then encapsulate all of that? Because you've already said today that you've got your fingers in many pies, but it's trying to manage that so that the data that you receive is giving you the best measurement and the best progress that you can have that will give you the opportunity to then succeed.
So you're absolutely right, and one of the sort of strange things about our place and time, the previous strategy was when it was launched, which was before my time, there was no measurement framework for it, and it was only about 18 months or 2 years into it that we developed it, and you had the 13 indicators. This time in the strategy, we've set out a range of outputs or outcomes that we want to try and achieve, and alongside each of them, we've identified what the data source is going to be, and we've checked that data source is able to give us what we need. And I alluded earlier on to the fact that while this is not a HES strategy, people look to us, understandably, to steer it and drive it. And so we've created a small team, and one of them is a data analyst, because we know how important the data and monitoring progress actually is. I think, however, my only comment would be there is data and there's data, and actually not all of the tracking is quantitative. And there's lots of good examples and case studies out there that we're trying to gather. But I would summarise that simply by saying, you know, while there's lots of good things from the previous strategy that we want to take forward, there's also lessons that we learn, and having some framework for measuring progress and how we get the data to evidence it has been built in from the start.
And I think that has to be the case, because if you are going to get the ultimate goal that you're trying to achieve, then you need to make sure that that's there. So all of that then comes down to resource and financing and how you framework that. And within the strategy, you've given some ideas as and the progress that you want to see, and the elements that you've identified that are priorities. But there are also, within the strategy, areas that you know you want to do, but you might not be able to do because you are constrained by time, the geography or something, or the finances behind that. So it's how do you balance that to ensure that you get what you want to achieve so that your strategy actually succeeds? Because in some ways, if it doesn't go that far, it will fail.
Yeah. So I think maybe my first observation would be the fact we've only got three priorities gives a focus. As I said earlier, when we reviewed that at a previous version, there was at least 9 or 10. So we thought, for the reasons you articulate, you know, there's no point. So let's really focus. So that I think is part of it. I think when we map the delivery under the previous strategy was pretty much through working groups, and we'll continue with some of these. The skills one, for example, has made good progress. There's more to go, so that will continue. But other issues like looking for the fiscal frame, the VAT, in fact, that doesn't need a working group. That just needs a bit of work. In fact, we've done it, and you know, we'll be saying something about it quite soon. So a more flexible delivery model. But the resource issue, let's be honest, it will be a challenge. And we've got, I think, three priorities, and I think a reasonable list of actions under each one. They'll have to be prioritised within the strategy, I guess, going forward. I think, secondly, we all know the financial constraints that we're all operating in. So, you know, nobody knows the budgets for next year yet, so that'll be a factor. But two other sort of strings to that. One is, I go back to this point about aligning grant schemes across the sector. We've changed ours. We've worked very closely with the lottery and aligned So for organisations wishing to bid in for projects and so on, you know, rather than you've got a process and you've got a process and, you know, bringing it together. And my final point in that is, this is not a strategy, go back to where it started, this is not a strategy for the historic environment delivered by the historic environment sector. The fact that it's got net zero at the heart of it and other priorities says we need to get that mainstreaming across the sector and across government and be able to access other pots of money, frankly. So green initiatives or net zero. So if the strategy is not just for delivery by the sector, the funding should not just be constrained within the culture portfolio as well. And so I've already had conversations with other bits of government about how we try and align around this. I'll be honest, it's not going to be easy, because for too long, culture and the historic environment has been seen as a separate thing off to right field and not mainstream. So it won't necessarily be easy to do. But the fact that the priorities are so mainstream, I think, gives us an opportunity. So resource will be a challenge, but I think these are three or four ways in which we're trying to sort of alleviate it.
Yeah, I'll just come in on a couple of points there. I mean, we did learn an awful lot from the previous strategy. And as Alex said, actually, it took 3 years before a measurement framework was put in place for the previous strategy, and then we've been reporting against that. But one thing we learned from the having 13 KPIs is that it was too many, but also that there was a challenge in terms of acquiring the data from the sector. In effect, large organisations like HES or the National Trust for Scotland could produce the data because they can provide that. But many small organisations, which is the rump of the sector, to be perfectly honest, just couldn't engage except for case studies. And we took that learning into the framework which we produced there. And so their outcomes, so their end goals, which means the metrics are multi-layered and sit under those and feed them. But they're designed to be scalable, they're designed to be flexible, and they're designed to be accessible. And I think Elsa McFarlane from BESS made that point, and they were consulted on as well with that in mind, so that small or large organisations can be seen as being part of that framework, and we'll put some more shape on it yet to come, and can be seen to be contributing and can be visibly contributing as well through the microsite that we've produced to demonstrate progress. And that means, because the strategy is about people and places as much as it's about heritage assets, it means that at a certain level we will still produce the things you're used to in terms of Scotland's historic environment audit, like the punchy stats about how much we contribute economically across the nation or how many jobs or how many volunteers. But at another level, we'll be able to tell in a more qualitative sense meaningful stories, I think, from regional and locally about how the historic environment is delivering to well-being and other agendas. And we'll also have the delivery framework and activity mapped in a kind of theory of change type model. This is where we've said we'd go, and this is the impact of things. And that is the intention. And at year one in June, taking the launch date as June 23, we do intend to produce what would be our first progress report, but also, in a sense, the baseline for the year. And there will be gaps. There'll always be gaps in data, because while the sector is awash in data, it's not necessarily always got the right data. But I think this is about direction of travel and not always sweating the fact that you haven't got the right data, because you could spend decades sometimes getting perfect data. But actually, this is about improvement, and that's the intention.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Mr. Bibby?
The panel. Last week we heard concerns about skill shortages in the sector, particularly in relation to retrofitting historic buildings. Skills Development Scotland noted they were currently reviewing apprenticeships to ensure skills needs were being embedded into many different qualifications, such as plastering, and you've talked about the importance of mainstreaming already. We did hear some evidence around the skills plan was working well in relation to digital marketing and financial planning, but clearly there's a big issue in relation to those skills around retrofitting. The lack of apprenticeships in Scotland, for example, in stonemasonry, we were told, has more to do with the demand from employers to take on apprenticeships being low. Do you recognise this? What can Historic Environment Scotland do to encourage skills development through apprenticeships? And what needs to be done to encourage more employers to take on apprenticeships?
So, in my very first meeting OPIT, as was in the, sort of, in the SHEF, the Strategic Historic Environment Forum. This was item number one, you know, about 7 years ago. And that's why I went and knocked the door of the Chief Exec of SDS and said, Damien, I need help to put together a SIP, a Skills Investment Plan for the sector. And part of the argument against it, not from Damien but from others, was, well, what we do is part of construction, and what we do is part of tourism, and what we do is part of digital and creative industry and so on. But actually, I said, it's really, really important that we have a sector skills investment plan with heritage of the historic environment on the front cover. And I think, you know, having that group, and which has had almost developed a life of its own, because there are working groups drawn from FEHE across all parts of the skills and education landscape working to implement that plan and a modification of the plan. And therefore, it's why in the first quarter of next year, probably February, March time, we will launch a refreshed version of that. Now, there are big skills gaps, and the one which gets a lot of airtime is particularly around stonemasonry, and I'll just give you my take on that. I chaired a round table in Stirling either earlier this year or end of last year with all parts of the sector around about it, and I don't think there is an issue of people wanting to enter the sector. I think the demand is there. We have a very significant traditional skills, stonemasonry and other crafts apprenticeship programme. I think we've got about 40 or so apprentices at any one time. We've picked up apprentices who have been left a wee bit high and dry when Edinburgh College pulled out. So we've done a deal with CITB, and we'll see these trainees and these apprentices through. However, the whole issue with stonemasonry and that is quite critical, because it's expensive. The demand is there, I think, from people wanting to do it, but it's expensive to provide. But it's not an easy fix, because what I heard from employers was the qualifications not fit for purpose. And it doesn't meet the needs of industry. So there's work going on now looking at the occupational standards and what the framework and what apprenticeships going forward needs to be. I think part of the challenge in taking people into the sector is that many years ago it was quite large companies. Now it's a lot of very small companies for whom taking on an apprentice is actually quite a commitment. And you know, the way the funding model works doesn't quite work. So my team have been doing a lot of work with Skills Development Scotland, Scottish Funding Council and Government to try and find a way forward. In fact, our Minister and the Skills Minister are meeting next week to try and find a way of bringing those two things together. My personal view is, I think it's going to need a bit of a left-field solution, because I don't think, if you like, mainstream, you know, FE sees it as either a priority. And particularly when times are difficult budget-wise, it's quite expensive to do these sort of things. So at the moment, you know, most of the apprenticeship training is done by us at Stirling or Elgin. And that reflects another thing, which is the demand for these skills, not just to repair castles, but to repair tenements and, you know, for retrofit and fabric conditions for energy efficiency. We need to have them around the country. And at the moment, it's very sort of central belt based. So it's why in the new sector strategy, skills will be a key issue going forward. Mm-hmm. A lot of progress has been made, but the stonemasonry issue is a here and now real challenge. Yeah.
Thanks for that answer, and I welcome that there's a the different ministers for skills and heritage are meeting to discuss that issue, because clearly it is a big issue. You mentioned, obviously, we're talking about the new strategy and a refreshed skills investment plan for the historic environment sector. Skills Development Scotland noted last week that a number of the SMART goals had not been achieved. Now, I know COVID was part of that, but they also said that those working on the review were hoping to use the goals in line with resources. And I know you've said before, we've talked about resources before more generally, but obviously in relation to skills as well, there'll never be enough resource, and you've got to balance, I think you said earlier, a sense of ambition with pragmatism. In terms of the new skills investment plan refreshed and not meeting those goals before and being more pragmatic in line with resources, is this more realistic and therefore less ambitious than the previous strategy and plan?
It's not less ambitious in skills. Okay. Take your first point about the numbers that were quoted to you last week. We don't recognise those numbers. The skills investment plan, as originally launched, we reckon about 59% of those actions have been delivered. However, actually, that's not really the key point, because in 2019, when COVID hit, the group that oversees the SIP revisited the actions, and some of them were not relevant in the context of COVID in a different world. So the baseline actually is that 61% of the actions in the previous SIP have been delivered. I think it's about 27% are work in progress, and actually that's a very small percentage won't happen or are being delayed. So we saw the numbers and we thought that doesn't quite tally with us. But in terms of the new strategy, you know, it's hard to say what issue is more important than any other, but skills is up there. And that's why, you know, ministers are meeting, because, you know, in a world where resources are tight, Scotland cannot achieve its net zero targets without the right number of skilled people to do it. So it's finding the mechanism, or finding the funding route, or finding the qualification framework that enables that to be delivered. And when the new SIP is launched, there's an awful lot of the objectives and the principles of the previous one still hold true. About encouraging more people into the sector, and we've done a lot of work working with SDS careers advisors and so on about increasing the awareness of careers in the sector with young people across Scotland. So there'll be a high degree of continuity, but in things like stonemasonry, green skills and so on, there'll be a heightened profile. So I don't think the new SIP is overly ambitious. I actually think it goes back to the whole thing about mainstreaming and not just seeing this as a culture or a heritage or a historic environment issue. This is an issue that we need to address, because the wider net zero aspirations are fundamentally hooked to it.
Thank you.
Mr. Patterson, can I just ask a supplementary on your comments here, which I, my understanding is it was around the apprenticeship model not being financially the right model. I just wonder if you give us a bit more detail on that and where the pinch points is. Is it with the colleges? Is it with employers? You know, how does it just not quite work?
It's not one dimensional. So part of it is about the cost. So to do stonemasonry training in a college is expensive, with all the kit and everything else you need. So when budgets are tough, that's a consideration. I think I go back to the qualification. And what I was hearing from a lot of the businesses in the sector is that actually we don't necessarily need everybody trained to full apprenticeship. There's different skills levels we need, but we're having to put people through the full thing to get the funding that follows the qualification. Then there's the national occupational standards that populate it. And then I think there's ways of spreading training across the country, which we need to look at as well. So it's not simply a case of it's expensive, which it is. It's maybe not, the qualifications are not fit for purpose, which makes it difficult for small businesses in particular to engage, because, you know, of all the evidence that has to be gathered, which some of them say actually that's not the evidence of competence we need, it's this. So we commissioned a review, a report into stonemasonry and the challenges, and it's come up with that sort of multi-factored, you know, issue. So if it simply was a case of, look, we need an extra X pounds and we can fix the stonemasonry issue, yes, we probably could, and there's things we could do with that, but there's wider issues around the qualifications and so on that make it up.
Do you subcontract all of that work, or do you have skilled people that actually work directly for your organisation?
No, we actually subcontract very little. So there are things we subcontract. There are specialist things we subcontract, but if you go to one of our sites and you see people working on the scaffolding, they'll be HES employees. So we've got a very talented, very well trained, very skilled squad of colleagues who do the work, and that's why in Stirling and in Elgin. And there's really only three training providers in Scotland now, Glasgow College and us. We are by far the biggest trainer of stonemasonry apprentices. So we train them for our own purposes, but we also train on behalf of the industry as well. And I mentioned a minute ago, we've come to an arrangement with CITB where we will pick up trainees who have been left in their apprenticeship partway through, and we'll see them through and get the complete apprenticeship. So we do a lot of it. One of the options is we could do more. We are an approved training centre, we're an SQA centre. You know, we do a lot of training, but what What we could get is something that's just a finger in the dike and it gets us through a couple of years. Mm. This is a long-term issue. And, put a finger in the dike for now would not be unhelpful, but it needs a more fundamental, sustainable solution.
So, this might seem a bit off the wall, but I recently visited my own local college, New College Lanarkshire Motherwell campus, and visited their robotic hub, where they're actually using cobots to do skilled sanding, welding work on repairs of turbines. Part of that is taking the risk factor away from people actually having to abseil on these machines, but they can be hoisted up and the robot does its work. So the skill comes from the person directing the robot. Have you looked at that technology for some of the work that you're doing to see if it's more commercially viable to... And given the skills shortage, if you can get some of that onto a different platform, would that work?
We use technology a lot. I'm not sure if we've looked at robotic stonemasons, but can I go and ask the question of the guys who might know and come back to you on
yes,
that?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And I'm sure my local college would be delighted to have a visit from you to look at some of those options. But thank you for that. I'm going to move to Mr. Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks very much. I've got a couple of questions. So first one is about fair work. It's good to see fair work principles embedded into the strategy, but I'm interested in how you extend those fair work principles to businesses that you work with, to organisations that are getting grant in aid.
There's two ways in which we do it. One is through our procurement. So organisations who are supplying us, We have a whole range of things that we ask them to do beyond just price and quality, but complying with fair work principles is one. And the second avenue is, and I think I saw something recently where this may have been sort of, the timeline for that may have been pushed out, but let me not be definitive in this, but through our grants. So the organisations that we support financially through our grants programme, we've got a grants programme of about £13-14 million a year, not into any of our properties, but into others. So we're trying to encourage the fair work agenda by making it a condition of grant offers, just as enterprise agencies, skills agencies more generally are having to do.
Mm-hmm. Has there been any pushback on that?
I'm not aware. Adam, are you aware?
Okay. No, not of any pushback. I was just going to add on that another consideration here is obviously our past, our future also look to other strategies, not just Scottish Government policy on this, but the museums galleries strategy, and obviously Fair Work features quite largely in there. Slightly different context because that's many small organisations and small museums and things like that. But we did that with the purpose that actually beyond the point of how we can directly address this issue through procurement and grants, which we are doing, as Alex says, how we can actually look, it's more influencing, I think, than being able to control and dictate this, how we can work with others in the wider sector to drive this through the sector.
Okay. Last week we spoke quite a bit about climate change, and it's obviously a key aspect of the strategy going forward, and you've mentioned already heat in buildings and fabric first approaches and that side of things. But I wanted to just pick up on another area, which is kind of less your direct emissions, but more the emissions that are coming from visitors, heritage, tourism. I'm interested in what work you're doing to address some of that. So in partnership perhaps with local authorities or with National Park or other bodies. I mean, we've heard, for example, I think Loch Lomond Trossachs National Park is wanting to set up kind of mobility hubs to encourage tourists to kind of arrive in the park, but then also to take a sustainable transport option to then go on to a visitor attraction. How are you kind of embedding that sort of partnership approach, working with councils and others to really drill down on unnecessary emissions?
I think maybe a couple of years ago, we were of the view that we need to do this, but what does it mean? Because there's lots of talk about responsible tourism or whatever else it might be. And how do you make it tangible? So we developed what we call a responsible tourism framework, which sets out exactly that. Tourism is vitally important. It's vitally important for every single part of Scotland. So there's nothing in what we are saying at all which we don't think, there's nothing we are saying which in any way downplays the importance of tourism, far from it. In fact, pretty important to us as an organisation in terms of ticket sales and income. However, there are things we can do. So, for example, we have been installing, you know, from an infrastructure point of view, you know, EV charging at sites and bike facilities at sites. We've got a SusTrans person working with us at the moment, embedded in us to do that. But there's a whole range of other things. Some of our admission products, how can we help people stay longer, see more? There are very practical things we're doing at sites in terms of reducing waste and so on. And then on partnership, so one of the big projects we've got just now through the Islands deal in Orkney is looking at how you embed those principles in what is quite an ambitious plan for, you know, the heart of Neolithic Orkney. So there are some of those, you know, bigger issues about rolling out infrastructure at our sites where it's possible to do and encourage other modes of transport, but also very practical things around things like waste and so on, all of which contributes to making the whole tourism and visitor experience more sustainable.
I mean, in terms of actual transport plannings, take Stirling Castle, for example, very small car park, tempting just to drive into the centre of town up to the castle, but then there are other options. Is that something that you would be working with the council to actually plan?
Yes. Yeah,
management of tourism, bearing in mind the historic nature of the city centre.
The answer to that is yes, and on the very specific of Stirling, I think this was pre-COVID, so we probably need to revisit it again, but we were looking at alternatives to transport to Stirling Castle. The car park gets awfully busy. It can sometimes, you're going to watch reversing cars and reversing buses. So we did look at what are the options for Stirling, but it's not just an option for us. It needs to be part of that wider consideration of people movement, visitor movement about the city. So yeah, I think this is something that's really important to us, and because we've got to measure visitor carbon emissions. You know, even if they're coming to our site as well as, you know, 10 other locations across Scotland, we've got a responsibility to try and measure and reduce the carbon footprint of all of that. We're not at an early stage, but there's a long way to go in what we can do. But I think we are practically taking steps, and I chair internally a climate group which looks at all the stuff we're doing around climate and delivery of a climate action plan. And that was one of the things we're discussing on Monday afternoon. Now we've got that responsible tourism framework out there, and our estates colleagues are aware of it. Yes, there's big things we can do around infrastructure, but actually it's practical local stuff that makes a difference.
Okay, my last question is just about how you're engaging with marginalised groups. So you obviously have your membership, card holders. I'm sure you have school visits and other visits to attractions. But, you know, there will be groups of people in Scotland who have not connected with the asset, who don't feel able to. There'll be other groups who perhaps struggle to engage, like New Scots as well. So I'm interested in how you're ensuring that our national heritage and the national assets, actually, you know, the benefit of that is felt by everybody in Scotland, including people who perhaps wouldn't come to an asset for a whole range of reasons, be it income or...
Yeah. Can I give you a couple of very quick observations, and I have my expert on the subject to my right. So we're very conscious of that, and in our corporate plan, operating plan, we talk about, you know, making the historic environment in our properties more accessible to everybody in Scotland. So you're right, we have a schools programme, we have a subsidised programme for schools, so a lot of schools use our sites for that type of thing. Last year, we increased the age from 5 to 7, at which you start paying at all, so for families, interest a family ticket as well. So we've tried to do that. This year, right now, the first Sunday of every month, from October through to March, is free. Anybody who lives in Scotland has free access to all our sites. I mean, some of our sites are free to access anyway, but, you know, you can go to Edinburgh Castle free of charge, and that's deliberately trying to encourage people who maybe wouldn't engage to engage with our sites. And then across the sector, for a number of years now, we've had access for £1 for all young Scot card holders. So there's a number of practical things, but there's almost a more of a philosophical approach to engaging more groups. Maybe ask Adam to comment.
we're coming at this in all sorts of different ways. I'll start really just looking inwards into HES in the first instance, because actually a key to this is your own employees, really, 1,500 or so employees, and how representative are they of broader, wider Scotland and its demography, which obviously varies from area to area. So naturally, we are, as a public sector body, required to produce equalities outcomes and mainstreaming reporting. But going beyond that, we've really been, I think, ramping up our activity in this area, targeting in both employees in terms of how we can improve access, looking at recruitment, encouraging those employees who are already part, we would say, of different equalities groups and represented in different ethnic minorities and so on, to set up their own internal forums with the support of senior leadership and drive change within the organisation. If you change within the organisation, it also helps you change externally. And also, we've been doing a number of other initiatives. I mean, Alex mentions a few located connected to the properties. We're doing a number of other pieces of work. We're looking at empire and colonialism around our properties, which will lead to a swathe of work around interpretation, reinterpretation of our sites and the stories we tell and how we engage more widely than we have traditionally, potentially. And we've also done a host of already a number of projects and programs of activity involving refugee groups and migrant groups around the Antonine Wall as an example. Talking about OPOF, bringing it back to OPOF, inclusion is at the heart of this and is an aspiration always, I think. We all know, I think, if we look at even just the national survey stats on that, those who engage with the cultural heritage in the round tend to be certain demographic. And so, quite rightly, as you point out, there are numbers who are not engaging, whether that's from social deprivation or from other areas. So we're looking at how we can approach that. And in the process of developing OPOF, we did actively target, in a way, engagement. There's one actually very enjoyable occasion where we met with a group of Kurdish refugees in Glasgow, actually, but engaging with them around local heritage and trying to involve local community interest as well around local history. So these are kind of small pockets of activity. It fed into our thinking, but actually that's an example of how I think we need to approach it. And again, it comes back to an earlier point that this is about how we do things on the ground quite often. We can make changes to our recruitment process, we can make other changes, but actually it's how we do it on the ground and how we work with others, other organisations that are more located in that space, collaboratively in partnership to actually tell the stories that people want to hear and allow them to feel engaged. Now, naturally, with OPOF also, I mean, this is more housekeeping in a way, we also have been keen to make it more accessible with easy read versions and things like that. And moving forward, I think our intent as well in the way we're looking how we communicate will become more accessible.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
You know, I have to declare an interest, which I did when I first joined the committee, that my partner is the minister responsible for this area, but I'll do that now. I thought about it last week and didn't do it. Just to say, I really enjoyed your analogy about the lack of stonemasons when you talked about a finger in the dike. I thought it was very appropriate. On Clotmanin, there's tower, there's good news and bad news, and it relates to my substantive question. The good news is it's open 24 hours a day, every day of the year, except for St Andrew's Day. But the problem is it's only open to external viewing. My point was really about internal. And I see, because I've got the benefit of the internet, which you wouldn't have had, that it's been talked about at least since 2017. The reason I mention it is, though, because, and it'll be true of so many different sites and buildings that you have, Clotmanin Tower was owned by Robert de Bruce, and it's said, I don't know whether it's true or not, that he held a parliament there as well. So you can see the broader interest, and it's on that issue, which I raised last week. I'd just like to hear a bit more about, you've mentioned the importance of ticket receipts and numbers going through. I mentioned last week as well that when we took William Wallace's sword to the United States and called it the Braveheart sword, the consequence of that was a huge uptick in the numbers going through the Wallace Monument, which I know is owned by the council, not by his. And it's that kind of thing, in a situation where finances are grim and about to get grimmer, whether you're sufficiently looking at how you can tap into the history and legacy of some of these buildings, particularly in relation to whether it's a diaspora or overseas visitors might be interested, because the cost of living pressures, it's probably hard to get more people domestically going. But whether how seriously and how vigorously you look at maximising revenue from that source?
Commercial income or non-grant and aid income, vitally important to us. I think pre-COVID, over 60% of our income was self-generated, just under 40% grant and aid. It switched over COVID, but we're heading back that way, which forces us to think, well, what other opportunities are there? So there are three or four sort of things we're doing. One is our commercial activity. I think I mentioned to the committee before, one of the things we'd like to do is change our business model. And we'll progress that and get more flexibility. So hopefully we can get that over the line before the end of the financial year. That basically means that if we push the boat out on commercial activities, then we want to be able to retain that and reinvest it in the historic environment at the moment. And all NDPBs have this restriction at the moment. We need permission to use it, or it's offset against reduction in grant aid. So our business model work is really important, and ministers and others have been very supportive in that. The other strand we're looking at is fundraising. Now, I'll be honest, fundraising has not really been a big part of what we do over recent years. It's interesting, the tourism market has come back much more strongly than we anticipated. So our commercial income this year is slightly ahead of where we forecast. But going forward, with costs only going one way, we need to look at other avenues. So we're taking sort of tentative steps, I would say, but we haven't yet tapped into the diaspora idea, but it's on our list. So some of the things we are doing, for example, is an awful lot of our sites are free to access. So can you be tapping donate type of arrangement at some of our sites? We're pretty good at tapping into research funds. Through research councils and other things as well. So actually we have a fundraising plan that we want to ratchet up, and we've got a couple of people working in our fundraising activity now. We need to be careful because we can sometimes be seen as, if you like, the big organisation in a sector which is quite with lots of small, and therefore we need to be careful as to how we pitch our fundraising. But certainly tapping into that wider diaspora is something we have in our minds. And in fact, a couple of comments have been made to me over the last couple of years, particularly around some of our sites where we've had restrictions, that given the affinity of a particular clan or whatever else, is there an opportunity to partner in terms of a project going forward? So I would say it's early stages, but it's certainly something we can look at.
I just wonder whether doing that on a more rigorous basis, and to stop being parochial a bit more in the area, first thinking about somewhere like Badby in the Highlands, which is pretty grim for its significance, but also to go and visit, you're on the edge of a cliff, so I can imagine why you might want to be careful about how you get people there. But the interest you could probably engender from, especially from Canada and the States, because that's where a lot of the immigration came from. It's just to see whether it's possible, and it would be true of any new potential acquisitions that you had as well, to actually make part of your criteria, you know, what you could tap into. I mean, the Americans, for example, the biggest spenders when they come here, and they are coming back. I've seen that around here as well. But the potential for really dramatically increased income, if you can tap into that seam of what interests people, and it'd be true of different countries as well, is pretty huge. So is there any capacity to do it on a individual site basis and see what the potential is there?
There is. But I think my answer would probably be the same as I gave you to the last question. It's on our radar as something we want to do. Up until now, it's not really been something we've had to do or had the flexibility within our model to benefit from. But whether it's a site-specific or whether it's a more general approach, yes, we can do it. And I think the first step we've taken is putting in place a small fundraising team to start to develop. Now, whether it's through SDI or through Scottish Business Network or through some other diaspora organisations, I think we can tap into it. So it's probably my glibest answer of the morning. It's on our plan to do, but to be honest, we haven't actually tapped it properly yet.
That's all, thanks.
Thank you. Mr Cameron?
On that last point, always keen to tap into the clan networks across the world. Can I return to the question of skills and to ask a very broad but I think quite fundamental question? And it's picking up on the evidence of Brian Dixon last week, who said, and I quote, "Even if the National Trust for Scotland had the finances to deliver large-scale capital works across Scotland, I do not think that we would have the skills available in Scotland to do so. That strikes me as pretty significant. I mean, firstly, do you agree with that? And also, what, you know, how do we sort this out?
Yeah, I do agree. And it goes back to my earlier comment about it's hard to say one priority is more important than the other, but skills underpins so much of what we do. So the whole thing about net zero and, you know, maintaining properties and so on is fundamentally back to the skills. So I do agree with Brian. And you know, that's why I said, you know, the old skills investment plan and the new one is so fundamentally important to the delivery of not just this, the new strategy, but the wider dimensions. It's going to be challenging because we all know the world of education and budgets at the moment, which is why I think some more creative approaches is worth looking at. I also think there are philanthropic opportunities around skills, which we should, well, we have explored and we should continue to explore. My personal view is the demand is huge. Doing it the way we've always done it won't get us to an answer. And, you know, the conversations next week between ministers will hopefully help move some of that forward. But I agree with Brian, and, you know, Brian has sat in the skills group that's developed the SIP and so on. So that's true. I think the other thing I would say on this is that because it is such a common issue, whether it's us or NTS or Scottish Canals or others, we're actually talking just now about how we don't just look after our own skills needs, but how do we come together and find a collective way forward about doing it. And, you know, that made sense anyway. You know, did the skills investment plan stimulate it? Possibly, but it just makes sense. So I think if we're going to do more training, and Brian needs more and John needs more at the Canals, let's try and find a joined up way of doing it, working with the skills organisations, SDS, SFC, and so on.
Thank you. I didn't have talked to Jackson.
You pretty much covered it. I would say, really, it's a bigger issue than the sector, very much so. And it requires the education and skills sectors really to be on board and working with us. And we know that the ministers are talking to this point next week. It is, as so much across the new strategy, can only be delivered working cross-sectorally and being innovative, probably, in terms of how we source funding with private sector.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I think we have now exhausted all questions. Mr. Patterson, Dr. Jackson, thank you very much for your attendance at the committee. It's been a really interesting session with you, and I'm sure we'll look forward to finding out what the Lookabout E-Tower ends up down the line. So thank you very much. On that note, I'm going to close, and we move into private session. We'll have a short comfort break. Thank you.